We welcome those on live stream also. Tonight we're going to be in John 4, verses 11 through 14. This will be our 44th exposition of this book. This is one of the well-known incidents of Scripture that you want to be familiar with. A lot made known here. Now we learn from this text and from others that when Jesus engages the intellect of a person, he's challenging. Jesus never talked really like simple-like. I mean, you have to be familiar with what Jesus said to know this, but he didn't talk real simple like little children could understand. They did not understand what he said.
Right.
He'd bless them, but he didn't, no record of him ever teaching them. But they did learn from the people who did hear Jesus, and probably the children no doubt detected that Jesus was kind and gentle and thoughtful, and they picked up on that, all right. But Jesus stretches your mind.
Amen.
He stretches the mind of an individual so they think deeper and farther than they did before. Jesus will do that for you. Take, for example, how he challenged this woman. If thou knewest the gift of God. See, all of a sudden, this is... He's stretching her mind.
Yeah.
How could a thought be further away from everyday life than that?
Mm-hmm.
Or if you knew who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink. See, he's stretching her.
Yeah.
You have to look into that. These are sayings that you have to look into. You have to ponder them. She thought he was just an ordinary Jewish man.
Yeah.
But she's finding out he wasn't. She said, if thou being a Jew, see, that was the loftiest perception she had of Jesus, was he was, quote, a Jew.
Uh-huh.
That's just about as general as you could get. And I suppose that apart from Moses, who I understand the Samaritans accepted, they accepted the writings of Moses, but not the prophets. So she'd not been told anything, not from the Samaritan side, about a Messiah. She didn't know anything about this. We'll find it from their teaching. She found that she knew enough. She's going to tell you later. She knew enough. She'd picked up probably from the Jews that a Christ was coming, but her scriptural knowledge didn't get it from scriptural knowledge. With the few words, Jesus stretched her mind to consider things that were never before in the framework of her thought. And he's not talking about something philosophical, that is just a thought. This is someone she's facing, talking with. It's obvious that she hadn't thought of God as giving gifts. That apparently wasn't the way she thought of God. And it might surprise you that there remain a lot of religious people, some even professing Christians, they don't think of God as giving gifts. It's not the way they think of him. In my own view, I think that many people make the mistake of introducing Christ or what he brings in a manner that is too close to the earth. They try and make Jesus too much like this world. They like it. They introduce everyday life and how Jesus can help and so forth. But they're clouding who Jesus was. This kind of talk clouds who Jesus is. It doesn't open up who he is. Jesus must be introduced within the context of the will of God. That's the context you got to present Christ. You don't present Christ in the context of the need of man.
Yeah.
But if you know Scripture, you just have to search through people that preached, and that's not how they introduced Jesus.
Right.
Paul preached to Athens, the Grecian society. He didn't bring up a lot of Grecian peculiarities and things that He didn't bring that up at all. This is not how you introduce Jesus.
Yeah.
Yet people are taught to do this. Mm-hmm. Jesus can help you. That's kind of the understatement of the day, but and Jesus can make your marriage work. And there's no example of anything like this in Scripture. Now, you don't have to take my word for it. Do your homework and check the Scripture, and you'll see this is not how Jesus is presented, because that's too earthy. The closer you get to earth, the more clouded Jesus becomes. If you get immersed in the affairs of this world, you will not think about Jesus. Now, your own experience will attest this to you. You get all wrapped up in the problems. We've all got problems. I mean, if everyone here aired their problems tonight, we'd be here a long time. But the more we aired them, the less we'd think about Christ.
Amen.
You remember that when Angel Gabriel appeared to Mary, he stretched her mind. She talked about her being a virgin having a child. Whoa, it stretched her mind.
Amen.
This is how God is. You don't want to think, you won't have anything to do with God.
Mm-hmm.
And the Ethiopian eunuch, he was reading the scripture and he's stretching his mind. He read about, the prophet's talking about somebody who's suffering and so forth, but so he asked Philip, who's he talking about? Is he talking about himself or some other man? See, this is what happens when you immerse yourself in Scripture and you immerse yourself in thinking about God. You commence thinking. You're not thinking like an ordinary person.
Yeah.
And you'll come across as being odd. Well, one of us is odd.
Yeah.
I'm willing to admit this. When I talk to someone in the world, I'm willing to admit one of us is odd.
Yeah.
We just need to establish which one it is, you know. Now, I'm not speaking of just intellectual inquiry, library type knowledge. That's not what we're talking about. When you liken the workings of God to earthly experiences, you water them down. It's like the things of God are like concentrated, but they're opened up in your heart. They're not opened up by mixing them with earthly experiences and things of the world and parallels and this sort of thing. See, Jesus wanted to hide the truth. He spoke in parables. That's what he said. Now, this is not guesswork. That's what he said. The disciples couldn't figure out how come you're talking to the multitudes in parables, but you're straight up with us. You tell. Well, he says, I don't want them to understand.
Right.
Why? Because they weren't interested. Even though they grouped out, were large groups. What God has to give cannot be obtained from any other source. Talk about peace, you can't get that anywhere else. Not from any man, not from any place on earth. You can't get a quietness of soul. You can't get that from anybody but God. The peace of God ruling your heart and your mind, you can't get that.
Mm-hmm.
A psychiatrist can't give that to you. A counselor can't give that. He can't give it to you, not what God gives.
Yeah.
The joy of the Lord, you can't get that from anybody else. This is going to become apparent in this text before us. So let's read this. John 4:11-14. Jesus is talking to a Samaritan woman at the well of Jacob. He has told her, if you knew the gift of God and who you were talking to, you would have asked me for something to drink. Now, we dealt with that last week, but that's something to think about. That's something to think about. The woman saith unto him, Sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank from himself and his children and his cattle? Jesus answered and said unto her, Whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whoso drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into life everlasting.
Amen.
All right, do you think all of that was really plain to that woman? Why, it's not all that plain to people today.
Yeah.
Church people.
Yeah.
It challenges us to think about it. Well, I personally love the challenging way Jesus talks. Let's have done with mediocrity.
Yeah.
Average, common. Mm-hmm. Let's kick it out the back door.
Yeah.
It hasn't done much for anybody. Now, this woman can't process what Jesus has said. If you knew what the gift of God was, if you knew what the gift of God was, and if you knew who you're talking to. See, this, she couldn't process it. It was over her head. Do you know the only way you can learn is to hear something that's over your head? This is, all the schools are built on this. Huh? Teaching your children is built on this principle. The only way to learn is to teach over their head. I mean, it's not like a mile over the head. It's a few inches over their head. But it's got to be something they got to. So the woman responds to him, well, thou hast nothing to draw with. She came to the well to draw water. She obviously had some kind of a vessel with her. It's also obvious there wasn't like a vessel provided there, sitting there for whoever. If it was, it was intended to be taken. And she looks and she sees Jesus doesn't have a vessel. Nothing to draw with. And yet he's offering me water. She'd already deduced that the water wasn't accessible from the well, at least not with the bucket she had. She couldn't get it because it's deep, really deep. You have nothing to draw with. Spiritually speaking, this is like presenting Jesus to a person with a naturally superior and cultured mind. They're educated. You present Jesus to them. They're like this woman here. They know they don't have what it takes to comprehend what you're saying. All you have to do is talk to a sharp, intellectual, gifted person about the things of God, and pretty soon they'll see, whoa, this takes a little more than I got. This is just the way it is, brother. And this woman picked up on this. The carnal mind or the natural man cannot pick up on the things of God. It's not that they're like dumb. It isn't that. It's that these things are of another order. They require a different kind of mind. And God will give the person that kind of mind. But it does require it. You can't reach low enough into human nature to clarify the things of God. May come way down and say it's like this and it's like that and it's like a car and it's like a house, but you can't get low enough to clarify the things of God. That's not the way they're made clear. Such words are like to sound doctrine, condescending words, talking to adults like they're little children, trying to, this is like that and this is like the other, and you're making these parallels. That's like putting valuable treasure coins in a bag full of holes. The world's wisdom, the best of it. We're not talking about the kind of wisdom to make drugs and stuff like this. We're talking about intellectual disciplines. They're like holes in the bag of the mind. The things of God leak out through that kind of wisdom. The Athenians, these were like wise men. They were philosophers, educated men. People today are like dwarfs mentally compared to those ancient Athenians. But they could not handle the things of God. Here's how the scripture puts it. Paul said, we speak not in words taught by human wisdom, but in those taught by the Spirit, combining spiritual thoughts with spiritual words.
Amen.
That's the New American Standard. Combining spiritual things with spiritual is how the King James Version says. That is, the things we talk about in Christ are real.
Yeah.
They're realities. They're not figments of the imagination. They're not just ideas. But to communicate them, the words have to match.
Yeah.
Words are like containers.
Mm-hmm.
You can't bring with you common language and pour the things of God into it. It'll just leak out.
Mm-hmm.
You say, well, people don't know what the words mean. Teach the people what the words mean. I mean, what's so difficult about this? If you were a nuclear physicist and you're trying to train someone else, you don't like talking. You're speaking to them mathematical formulae and things that are difficult to understand, but you teach them what that language means.
That's right. Yeah. Uh-huh.
When I was promoted into the technical field of manufacturing in the management position, I didn't know anything at all about the field I was going to manage. And I had to go to school to learn to read the problems. Trigonometry and this, they were posted in symbols. I didn't even know what the problems said.
Mm-hmm.
And I had to learn about that language. Now, when you come into Christ, you got to learn about the language.
Yeah,
it's scriptural language.
Yeah.
You have to learn about this. You can't just pick it up easily. We understand that. And people not interested, they'll give up after a while.
Uh-huh, yes.
Said, I just don't understand. But if you will immerse yourself in Scripture, God will help you understand it. Pretty soon you'll put some things together. And, oh, I see that now.
Yes.
And it'll come to you. That's what Jesus is doing here. He's going to talk to her, so she's going to have to do some thinking and assemble what she said, and we'll find before this whole event is over, we'll find that it gels. She found out what he was saying.
Yeah.
At first, it was very hard to understand. She said, the well is deep. Some people have estimated even today, the well is still exists today. And they estimate it's like 70 feet now, but it used to be pretty deep. But it was so deep, no one had ever really, they were taking water off the top is what they were doing. They let their bucket down, they just, maybe a few feet from the top, they just took water off the top all the time. They never got into the depths. Now listen to what I'm telling you here. There's a lot of people that never get down into the things of God. The deep things of God, as Scripture says, they never get down, they're always skimming off the top. And this, you can start out like this. I understand, matter of fact, you probably have to start out that way, but eventually you got to let your bucket down a bit deeper. You got to get down deeper where you got to do some thinking, where you don't just come up with automatically with conclusions. You got to think the thing out. Because this well of salvation is a lot deeper than Jacob's well was. And Jacob's well was deep. This woman, however deep it was, the rope and bucket she had didn't get down very as deep as that well was. And maybe this water he's talking about, maybe it was down at a lower level down there.
Uh-huh.
How are we going to get down there to it? Yes.
And then you consider that it takes more investment, more time when you go deeper.
Yes, exactly. Now, Jesus said he'd give her water. Now, she's wondering, how are you going to get it to me?
Yeah.
I can't reach. My bucket won't reach. That you don't have a bucket. How are we going to get this? One of the embarrassing weaknesses of the Christianity of our day is that it's just plain too simple. It's actually an insult to someone's intelligence. If you're a thinker, that's what you are, you will be bored by most Christianity.
Yeah.
It's not designed for thinkers.
Mm-hmm.
It's designed for people that just, they're like a spider. A spider can walk on water. They just kind of walk around on top of, never get into anything. And that's a big weakness. Because I don't know how you'd prove that God works through something like that. Maybe you can, but well, you'll have to work at it. This is not how God works. So if you just like flirt with the truth, play around with it, you don't get into it, you won't get what you need. Not at all. Now she asked him, "Are thou greater than our father Jacob?" They did know what they, the God of Jacob, they thought they were related to Jacob. Samaritans. They'd been taught that they were related to Jacob. Jacob's our father. Well, Jacob wasn't their father. They weren't related to Jacob at all. They didn't have any connection at all to the Abrahamic lineage. They were a mixed race. Some Babylonians and people from other countries came in, and the Jews married them, and they were the product of a mixed marriage. They weren't the children of Jacob at all, but that's what they've been taught. Our father, Jacob. Samaritans were taught they descended from Joseph, but they didn't descend from Joseph. They were living in the land that was promised to Abraham. It wasn't their land, never was their land. Israel was, God kicked them out of the land because they were unfaithful. The king of Assyria imported people from other nations. These people came in there and brought their gods with them. Remember? The scripture tells us that God sent lions in the country. Kind of wake them up. So the king of Assyria said, better go out there and find some priest. And that he can teach the people about the manner of the God. Somehow we're agitating the God. What if somebody in America said, you know, I think we're agitating God. Oh, this is how these people thought.
Yeah, that's right.
This is how these people thought. We got these wild lions coming in here, killing off some of the people. We've got whoever they worship, the Jews, we've upset their God. Well, would that be something if somebody came to a conclusion like that? But that's what they did. Now this was, and then she, are you greater than Jacob? Actually, that was kind of an insulting inquiry, but she meant well by it. But it was asking Jesus if he was greater than Jacob. He's the one Jacob was looking for. So it was not spiritually dignified, and so Jesus really won't answer it. He won't say, no, I'm not. He will not answer it. He was gracious in not answering it. Because he couldn't have answered it like with a smile on his face and his arm around her. This is not, it was an insulting question. But he just passed over it. It ought to be noted that at this point, when something from God is mixed with something from the world, it can be the scripture, it can be an idea about Jesus, it can be apostles' doctrine. When something from God is mixed with something from the world, it ceases to be associated with God.
Amen. Yep.
The church hasn't learned this at all. But I'm telling you, this is the truth. The scribes and Pharisees took their traditions and they mixed them with scripture. And at that point he said, you make void the word of God. It wasn't the word of God anymore. And you see this in this right here. When a person mixes the things of Jesus with the things of the world, they come up with, quote, another Jesus. 2 Corinthians 11:4. Another, and I'm afraid we have the existence of another Jesus. It's not the real Jesus. We know it's not the real Jesus because it's not producing the things Jesus produces. If people say they're connected with Jesus and they're living a different way, they got a different Jesus.
That's right.
It's not the real Jesus. There are people who assume their association with Jesus because they belong to this church or that church. Maybe they think because they belong to this congregation. Maybe they think that is what validates. No. This is not what validates your connection with Jesus. If you have a certain type of theology, some people think that's what validates their association with Jesus. Your association with Jesus, now hear me out on this, your association with Jesus is validated by the way you live. That tells a story. If you're living sloppy, that's just not the way Jesus lives. A legitimate identity with Jesus is confirmed when his attributes are found in the people that profess allegiance with him.
Amen.
He's the firstborn among many brethren, and his brethren are like him.
Amen.
And the part that isn't like them is we're being conformed to the image of his son. That's God's purpose, to conform, shape us to be like his son. Now that means cutting some stuff off and adding some stuff in his place. You won't get something from God till stuff that God doesn't approve is taken off. Because it's going to fill the gap. What God gives fills the gap of what you got rid of. So if you didn't get rid of anything, you didn't get anything. That's just the way it is. Now, God starts it out when you're baptized into Christ, he just lops all the sin off. Then he gives his righteousness to you to take its place, see? Then the rest of your life is lived like this. You take off what doesn't belong there. You put on what does belong there. Those are the people that are associated with Jesus. They're all in a state of growth. Now, understand, they're all in a state of growth. Well, Jesus now answers the question. She says, now look, you don't have anything to draw water with. The well is very deep. Are you greater than our father? I mean, can you dig a better well than Jacob dug? Jesus answered and said unto her, Jesus answered. Did you know that phrase, Jesus answered, is mentioned 64 times in the Gospels. Jesus, he's a communicator. He's the premier communicator. So if you want to learn from Jesus, Jesus answers.
Amen.
People who are prone to ask questions must remember this. When Jesus answers, he's not reciting from a liturgy or something.
Yeah, amen.
He's telling you straight up the way things are, just like he's going to do here.
Yeah.
And if you know this, it'll temper what you ask him. If you know that Jesus will be straightforward with you. Now, he will not intentionally wound or hurt anybody. He's not that way. If a person is like fragile, he won't break a bruised reed or quench a smoking flax. That he won't take a fragile person and lump them on the head. I mean, that is not the way Jesus is, but he'll be straight up with you. Speak to your heart, so to speak. You know, we're told to be ready for us, to be ready to give an answer to anyone that asks a reason for the hope that's within us. This is 1 Peter 3:15. Be ready to give an answer for why you live the way you do.
Yeah.
This means you're not living like the other people.
Mm-hmm.
It means they can pick up you're not living like that. You got some different kind of values.
Mm-hmm.
Be ready to give an answer.
Amen.
Now, if that's what he expects of you, don't you know Jesus is ready to give an answer?
Amen.
Jesus will give an answer too. He said, now listen, whoever drinks of this water, it's water in Jacob's well. Whoever drinks of this water. Now he's going to tell there's another kind of water. There's water, there's this water here. But I, what he's saying is, I'm going to talk to you about another kind of water.
Yeah.
Not this. The woman has asked a dual-sided question. Where are you going to get this water, and are you greater than Jacob? So his answer may appear to be avoiding her questions. He says, whoever drinks of this water shall thirst again. See, that doesn't sound like that answers either question.
Yeah.
But instead of Jesus coming down where she was, he's going to bring her up where he is.
Right.
See the difference?
Mm-hmm.
The water in Jacob's well, this water. It's the water the woman came to obtain. It's the water Jesus asked to drink from this water himself.
Uh-huh.
It's the only kind of drinking water with which he's familiar.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
This was it. But Jesus is going to introduce her to another type of water. Now, he's not going to suggest that the water he's talking about will be put in Jacob's well. No, Jacob's well is going to stay there, and she's still going to have to come back when she needs the kind of water that's in Jacob's well. She's still going to have to come back and draw that water out of that well. So we're talking about different water and additional water.
Yeah, yeah.
So she's going to have to learn to drink two ways.
Yeah, uh-huh.
He's not going to do away with drinking water out of Jacob's well, not as long as you're in the world. You're going to still have to do this, but you're going to have to drink another kind of water too. And I'm going to tell you about the other kind of water. You already know about this water. So the water is dissimilar to the water in Jacob's well, which he's not going to replace. See, there are things you have to do because you're in the world. You have to work, earn your living by the sweat of your face. All right, when you become a Christian, that doesn't stop.
That's right.
Yeah. You have to provide for your own, especially those of your own house. That doesn't stop.
Uh-huh.
You have to keep doing it. Now you're going to add. You're going to have to live two lives simultaneously.
Yeah.
And you'll be able to do it because one life you live will just be during a certain time of the day and a certain period of time and a certain place. But the other life you'll live all the time.
Yeah. Amen.
Whoever drinks of this water... It's the kind of drinking water she is familiar with. And actually, this woman is faced with a hurdle that multitudes of people have never been able to get over. There is more to life than life in the body.
Amen.
All right.
Yes.
Most people have never been able to get over this hurdle. So there are people recognizing this that have concocted a gospel that deals only with life in the world. That's the only kind of life it really deals with. See? But that's not what Jesus is dealing with. Mankind is more than flesh and blood. But this, very few people knew much about this prior to Christ. The old scriptures, writings of Moses and the prophets, did tell us there was such a thing as a soul. But not many people had any intelligent ideas about the soul. Some knew that there's a spirit in man, and the spirit of the Almighty gives him understanding. That was about the deepest thing they could think about. David knew his soul vacillated up and down. Why art thou cast down, O my soul? Your soul... in and out, up and down, on and off, happy and sad, see? But there was not much known about the soul. The same is true of the mind. The law said, love God with all your heart, soul, mind, strength. But there wasn't a lot taught about the mind and the possibilities of the mind, the activities of the mind. Now, the Gentiles... those that don't know God, those that didn't know God, the Jews, the Gentiles were the non-Jews, the people God had not spoken to, had not addressed, not made a covenant with, not taught. See, this are the Gentiles. The Gentiles, Jesus told his disciples how the Gentiles lived. Here's what he said. It's Matthew 6, 31 through 33. Take no thought. That means worry and thought.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Take no thought saying, what shall we eat? This is to people that didn't have anything to eat now. This isn't people that could go down to the Walmart.
Yeah, right.
These people didn't have anything. Take no thought saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles. Do the Gentiles seek. Now, when we first moved here, was the time Bill Clinton was elected as president. And the economy was the thing that brought him in. So I was on the radio with Brother Boyce Moten here at that time, and I told the people, this is what you've done. You've done, Christian people that voted him in because of the economy did what Jesus said not to do. They thought living in the body was the only kind of life. Okay? But it's not the only kind of life. It is not.
Amen.
After all these things that the Gentiles seek, but you, then he said, but you, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then God will see to it that you have those needs. See, that's how the kingdom of God works. You're, when you follow God, you don't... That doesn't mean you suddenly don't have anything. He'll supply your need.
Amen.
That's good because he's the one that really knows our need.
That's right.
That phrase, all these things will be added unto you, I think it reaches so much deeper than the physical need themselves. It's like Jesus saying, and the very essence of that need will be satisfied from
the inside out.
Yeah.
And you'll add all these things to you. That's another way of saying satisfaction. Satisfaction is the word that covers all of that.
Amen.
You'll be satisfied.
Yes, amen. Yeah, with food and raiment.
See, I think for the most part, Americans live a lifestyle that food and raiment is like, that doesn't... I mean, they want it, but they want so much more.
Well, yeah.
So when you say food and raiment, they're like, that's it?
Yeah.
That's all? But see, these really are the need. The other things are optional.
There's whole continents.
Yeah.
And this is what they have. This is all they have.
That's right.
And they don't have much of that.
Mm-hmm.
See, to this day, 2,000 years after Jesus has been exalted into heaven, to this day, there are few people that have a valid understanding of abundant life.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
What is abundant life?
Yeah.
Jesus said in John 10:10, I am come that you might have life and have it more abundantly.
Yes.
What is more abundantly? What kind of life is that? Well, some people say that means you have more stuff.
Yeah.
This is what they teach.
Oh, yeah.
Amen.
Maybe you had 2-3 cars, expensive cars. That's not what life more abundant.
Yes, amen.
More abundant means the life you have in Christ overshadows and swallows up the other life.
Yeah, amen.
It makes the other life second.
Mm-hmm.
And when you're living in this abundant life,
mm-hmm.
you have that. You're blessed with joy and peace and righteousness
in
the Holy Spirit. You're satisfied. And he doesn't deprive his people of any necessity.
Yeah, amen.
Your necessities are met. We know this by experience. Sister June and I. We know this by experience.
Yes.
When I retired from the manufacturing world, I didn't make chicken feed.
Mm-hmm.
I made a lot of money. And I wondered to myself if I was going to be able to adapt to such a tremendous change of resources. But you know, we haven't lost anything.
Yes, amen.
Even though we had a couple of experiences that were,
mm-hmm.
like one man took $100,000 from me.
Mm-hmm.
We still didn't lose anything.
Yeah.
We still don't have any debts.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, if we just check our pockets, we have nearly as much as we did when we had all that money.
Yeah.
What is that? See, when you devote yourself to God, you really do this. God sees to it that you have what you need, and you'll be satisfied. You'll be content. Godliness with contentment is great gain.
Amen.
You don't have to have an empire to have great gain.
Amen.
Now Jesus said, if you drink this water, you'll thirst again. The other versions say you'll be in need of it again. You'll become thirsty again. You'll get thirsty again and again. See, some versions didn't do a good job of translating this. When he says you'll not thirst, he doesn't mean you'll never have the sensation of thirst. That's not what he means.
Right.
In the scriptures, when someone thirsted, it meant they didn't have water. It didn't mean they hadn't had a drink in a while. When they thirsted in the wilderness, it was they didn't have water. Thirst indicated absence of water. Not scarcity of water, absence of water. See? When he says you'll never thirst, he means you'll never be without a source of water. The kind of water I'll give you to drink. The woman might have thought, if I just have a bigger vessel, I'll get a bigger vessel. But see, that vessel would still run out.
That's right.
And she'd still have to come back. And maybe she'd like to warehouse it, you know, store barrels of water. It still would, and there's stuff about water that sits, you know, it gets stagnant.
Like it, in this sense, liken it to a tree being planted by the rivers of water.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's right.
Mm-hmm.
So he's now introduced a condition of sufficiency that's totally foreign to this woman. Mm-hmm. The wisdom of the world can't supply what he's talking about. The wisdom of the world can't give you something that doesn't run out. Doesn't make any difference what it is. Whether it's supplies, whether it's wisdom, knowledge, math, whatever. The world, everything the world has the death tone upon it. It all passes away. Now Jesus, he commences talking about a source that will not leave. You'll always have the source. See, this means that this driving compulsion for quick fixes that the world has, this is not good.
Yeah.
Jesus brings permanent fixes.
Amen.
All right, now let's get into this a little bit more. Who's ever drinketh of this water, of the water that I shall give him, shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well springing up unto everlasting life. See, now this is what I call a pregnant sentence, with quadruplets.
Yeah.
It holds a secret to spiritual life. It's possible to get something from God that's always increasing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That means you never get bored.
Yeah.
Hmm? That means you'll never have to be reformed, recovered.
Yeah. That's right.
Amen.
Now, there are some people that are reformed and recovered, but it's not because they had to be.
That's right.
It's because they weren't drinking from the well that Jesus supplies. This fits well. If you drink the water that I give you, not that I'll sell you, water that I'll give you, you'll never thirst. That's another way of saying what the law could not do. If you were to keep the law perfectly, the water source still run out. Whosoever drinketh, some of the versions say, whoever takes the water, whoever drinks from the water, if anyone drinks from the water. Now, the Montgomery translation captured what it means. Whoever once drinks the water. Now I'm going to show you this, what he means. All you have to do is drink it once. Boy, this is good stuff, let me tell you.
Amen.
Now what the Lord gives must be appropriated. Not enough to say God gives, God gives, God gives, that's good, praise God, but It has to be appropriated or it doesn't mean anything. Mm-hmm. You have to get both hands wrapped around it and get a firm grasp on it.
Yeah.
If, for instance, if faith is given,
mm-hmm.
and the scriptures, I give you some scriptures, he has given to you to believe.
That's right.
We have obtained like precious faith.
Yeah.
You've received it when you believe. See?
Yes.
Who's the person who's been given faith? The person who believes.
That's right.
That person.
Amen.
All right, if God gives peace,
mm-hmm.
he gives peace, who can make trouble? If God gives peace, the person who receives it is letting the peace of God rule in their heart and mind.
That's right.
See,
yeah.
That's receiving it.
Mm-hmm.
If God gives repentance, says Jesus, Acts 5:31 says Jesus has been exalted to give repentance. The person who receives repentance repents.
That's right. Amen.
See?
Amen.
If grace is given and it's received, then in that person the grace of God teaches them to deny ungodliness and worldly lust and of soberly and righteously in this present world looking for the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
See, that's Titus 2:11 and 12. That's what, when you receive it, this is what happens.
Amen.
If you receive the love of God, then you'll love God, you'll love Christ, and you'll love the people of God.
Yes.
See, the world, brethren, has had enough of people who say they are saved, but they can't give any evidence of it.
Yes.
We've had enough of this.
Yeah.
We don't need any more.
Uh-huh.
A person simply cannot drink the water Jesus gives without it impacting him. You can't take what Jesus has to give without it affecting you and how you live and how you think. It can't happen. If it doesn't affect you, you didn't drink. Period.
Amen.
Our message to a person like that, you can drink, though.
Amen.
Jesus said he will give you water.
Yeah.
But you have to ask. Jesus said if you knew who it was, you would have asked.
Uh-huh.
He would never say no.
People are offering water from a different well.
That's right.
And so they say, well, I did drink. But see, they didn't drink from this well.
Not from this well.
No.
Now, he says, the water that I shall give him, not the water that I shall sell him.
Oh.
Now, there are some things that Jesus does sell.
Uh-huh, yes.
To the church of Laodicea that Jesus didn't have anything good to say about it. It was one of his churches. Here's what he said to them. He said, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire that ye may be rich, and white garments that ye may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness may not appear, and anoint your eyes with eye salve that ye may see. He, when you backslide, you got to buy. You have to give up something you got.
That's right. Yeah.
But when he gives you this water, he doesn't sell it. Water's not in that. You notice in that text, water's not in there.
Uh-huh.
Water has to do with eternal life.
Mm-hmm.
Now he says, you'll never thirst. Another version says, you'll never be thirsty, never be in need of drink again, never get thirsty again. Not thirst forever, shall never, no, never be thirsty anymore. See, those are all misrepresentations. Maybe they meant well, but that's not what he's saying. He's saying you won't be without the source. He's not saying you won't ever drink again. It's where you get the water from that he's going to point out.
yes.
Jesus is not speaking of the sensation of thirst, but the ability to satisfy the thirst. See? Now here's what he said. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him. Shall be in him, a well within.
Yeah.
Now Jesus will refer to this experience later at one of the feasts in John the 7th chapter. The water that I give him, now Jacob's water was in the well.
Yeah, that's right.
The water that I give him shall be in.
Uh-huh.
Going to put the well in him. Here's what he said. This spake, he said that, he that comes to me, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture said, out of his belly, been put in there, see? Out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Now, John, through the Holy Spirit, tells you what that means. The next verse. But this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive, for the Holy Ghost is not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. So what is this? The well within, that's another view of the gift of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Yes.
That's what that is. The Holy Spirit is, so to speak, the well.
Yeah, yeah.
Where does the fruit of the Spirit come from? The well.
That's
see, the
right.
Well. I'll put the well. I'll put the well.
Yeah.
In you. Paul refers to the Thessalonians. He said, God who's given you, given unto us the Holy Spirit.
That's
what he's talking about.
Yeah, amen.
The source of life will be deposited within you.
Yes. Amen.
No, you should not be up and down all the time.
This
cyclical living.
Yeah.
You may try and explain it, but you got to get away from it.
Yeah.
You got the well inside.
Yeah.
You don't have to go outside your heart to get the resource.
Yes.
He's given it to you. The Holy Spirit in Titus 3:5, Paul says in 3:5 and 6 says, which God has shed on us abundantly, see, copiously. It's become like a well. And if you don't quench this Spirit, if you don't grieve this Spirit, it'll begin to, it'll be more. It'll take up more of yourself. More of your Spirit will be filled. You'll be filled. That's what this is. This is the Holy Spirit deposited in a person. You're carrying the source of satisfaction. You're carrying it with you.
Yeah, amen.
Wherever you go, it's with you. Whether it's up, whether you're down, whether you're in a prison or out of the ocean, it's with you. He put it in you.
That's right. Amen.
How marvelous, how marvelous.
Amen.
The fruit of the Spirit. What is it? It's the well springing.
Yes. Amen.
It's the well springing up. It'll spring up.
Yes.
To life everlasting.
Amen.
See?
So, Brother Gervin, this answers the question. But he says, do all things heartily as unto the Lord and not as unto men. This is why you can do that.
That's right. Now, Solomon saw the tip of the iceberg here. Here's what he said. A good man shall be satisfied from himself.
Yeah.
That's Proverbs 14:14. A good man shall be satisfied from himself. Not his self-works, not his self-generated thoughts, from the well.
Yes. Uh-huh.
We know more about what he said than he did.
Yes.
Now, here's an expression of a man who is satisfied from within. Paul says, 2 Corinthians 1:12, our rejoicing is this, the testimony of our conscience.
Mm-hmm.
What? That's a within thing.
Yeah, that's right,
That's a within thing, a testimony of our conscience.
Uh-huh.
So people may criticize you, and you may see 1,000 things you've done wrong, but your conscience says, I've been cleansed, I've been washed, I've been justified. See, that's the Holy Spirit. Bearing witness with your spirit. That's what that is.
Yeah.
It's the well springing up. See, that's why it's so important.
Amen.
Not to grieve the Spirit or quench the Spirit or resist the Spirit. That's why it's important not to do that. And you can do it in this world. You can be around people that'll make you stifle the work of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
You just don't need to be around those kind of people.
That's right. Amen.
Now, I know you can't just totally get away from them. I know that. But where you're able to, don't be around somebody that stifles.
Amen.
Suffocates.
Yes.
The Holy Spirit's getting bubbling. We used to sing a song, it's bubbling, it's bubbling, it's bubbling in my soul. They're singing, they're shouting, since Jesus made me whole. And I don't ever want that to stop.
Amen.
Amen.
And whoever diminishes that flow, I just say goodbye.
Amen.
And whoever it causes it to flow, I say hello.
Amen.
a well springing up into a river that flows out.
Yes.
So Jesus said, he said, he that believes on me, as the scripture said, out. Not in, out.
Yes.
Out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Yeah. Now I must admit that I have a great desire for this. I don't want any like a little trickle coming out. I don't want anyone to say, what's that, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a mighty river, a torrential river.
Yeah.
It'll flow out and all. Now, the well's put in there. That's what the well is designed now, to well up and to overflow. And he tells you, don't do anything that stops that well from flowing.
That's right.
And pretty soon, you may not say a word, but sometimes you'll be around people and the rivers are flowing out. And they can tell something's different. Something's different about that person. What it is, it's the river.
Yeah.
It's the source that's been put inside of you. Never stop that well up, brother.
Yes,
now. Well, I'll tell you, that this thing did a lot for me.
Amen.
Thinking and pondering about it, what? It's still true if you just knew. If you knew the gift of God, if you knew what God was given, and if you knew what Jesus has to give you, you'd be on the initiative to get it.
That's right.
Now that's our purpose here.
Yes.
Our purpose here is to stir you up and for you to stir me up to get what Jesus is given.
Amen.
I'll close there.
I've got people. They seemed intelligent, but you know, when you offered them a good deal, they walked away from it. It's like they couldn't see it was a good deal.
Yeah, couldn't see it.
But see, this is, you can't find a better deal than this.
No.
You just can't. I mean, he takes away everything that's bad.
Yeah.
He'll take it away, and he gives you everything that's good. How could that be bad? Well, flesh don't want it, but flesh got to go anyway.
That's right.
One day or another, you're going to have to give it up. So it is a good deal.
Amen. Everybody can see this, catch.
Amen.
Yeah, Brother Sales.
Whenever Jesus said that we shall never thirst again, whenever we thirst, it means that we want the water because we don't have it right then. But we shall never thirst because we're always going to have the
You're
water.
You're exactly right.
Yes,
you
amen.
Got it. That's it.
Yeah.
It seems simple, see, but you could miss it, Brother Judah.
Jesus said, whoever drinks of this water shall thirst again.
Hmm.
And David in Psalm 23 said, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. That's what that's referring to. Whoever drinks of this water will need it again because they ran out. You alluded to it. It's however much you have, eventually it's going to be exhausted, it's going to run out. So this one version says, whoever once drinks of this water, you drink of that water, the source is in you, and you do drink it again, but you don't drink it again because you ran out.
That's right.
You're drinking it again because your capacity is being enlarged.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. I think that's right to say.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
Because when you come to Jesus, and then the source is in you. The source of the water is
that's
in you.
Exactly. Yeah.
With this, with just physical water that you can go to a faucet and get some. The source isn't there. The result is there.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
But with this, the source itself
is
in you.
Yeah, that's right.
So the source being in you means that your capacity is going to be enlarged.
Yeah.
So you do keep drinking, but not because you ran out.
Yeah. Find the well.
That's it.
Yep.
Find the well, and don't. The Holy Spirit's sensitive. Everybody understands this.
That's right.
The Holy Spirit says, don't grieve. The Holy Spirit, the well has stopped flowing. Believe me, I'm telling you the truth. Don't quench.
Amen.
Sometimes you'll have inclinations. I ought to do this, I ought to do that. Don't quench that.
That's right.
And we're holy aspirations we're talking about. Because if you do, the water stops flowing.
Yes.
You don't want that to happen. And the fact that it's with you means that you're never really without it.
Yes.
One time, Paul said he said, I spent a day and a night in the deep. That's all he said. Out in the midst of a stormy ocean, bobbing up and down out there for a day and a night. But he was a drinking from the well.
Yeah, amen.
That's how he survived. He was a drinking from the well.
Amen.
That's how you'll survive too, amen. Si. Anyone else tonight? Yes, Brother Jonathan.
And you emphasize this in each lesson in some ways, that what God offers, what Jesus offers, is something only they can give. And this water that we're talking about here, it's only from Christ. And you have the aspect of, I'm in a dry and thirsty land where
no water is.
So this, what the water he puts in us, it's in an environment where there's no water at all.
Yeah.
Hence,
amen.
It has to be put in.
Amen. All right, Sister Barb, we're ready for you.